The VSim prototype is an interface for interacting with computer models, much like Word is an interface for interacting with text. In building the software, our goal was to enable the use of 3D content for teaching and learning, and we specifically designed it with the needs of scholars, educators, and students in mind. Once you've opened a model, in this case, I'm going to open the Experiential Technology Center's version of the Pantheon, you can interact with it in a number of ways. Gamers will immediately recognize the first-person navigation mode and its WASD keyboard commands. W and S move forward and back, A and D move side to side. In flight simulation mode, the movement is controlled solely with the mouse. Left mouse button is forward thrust, right is reverse thrust. And object navigation mode mimics the interactions possible with Google Earth. VSim includes two important features for scholars working with 3D technologies and for in-service educators that might want to use 3D content in their classrooms. The first of these are the narratives, which work much like PowerPoint presentations but in 3D space. Everything related to the narratives is located along the top of the simulation window. Narratives can be packaged with a model, can be imported individually, or built from scratch and exported to share with colleagues and students. Clicking the plus icon on the narrative player starts the process to build a narrative. Add a title, description, and information about the author, and press OK. Press Open to launch the narrative editor and begin building your presentation. Click the plus icon to set your first keyframe. Then navigate through the environment until you find your second location, freeze. Click plus again to make a new node. Navigate again. Freeze. And plus to make a new node. Remember, the spacebar toggles between navigate and freeze, so you can interact with the environment or you can interact with the narratives and embedded resources. Clicking on those thumbnails, you can adjust the pause time on the nodes themselves and the transitions. And clicking edit on a node lets you add in text, and imagery on top of your nodes to create compelling presentations about the modeled environment. This narrative feature is important because it allows educators to prepare their lesson materials in advance so that they don't have to worry about flying and talking at the same time. And trust me, that's an important feature. Let's switch models now to look at VSim's second important feature, the embedded resources. For this, I'm going to open the Urban Simulation Team's model of the World's Columbian Exposition of 1893. Let me pick the file. It's a big model, so it takes a few seconds to load. Okay, there we go. Before we talk about the embedded resources, let me illustrate the power of the narratives by importing a few built for the exposition. I'll load two. One about the transportation building designed by Louis Sullivan, and the second one about the Street of Cairo installation on the Midway Plaisance. So if I pick the transportation building narrative and press open, you can see all of the individual nodes. And if we click on them, we jump to that node. Here's a section of the building. Here's a plan of the Golden Door. Let's check the pause time. That's okay. And what's here are some images from the actual exposition. And if I press play, that will start our pre-programmed tour. great. Okay, let's stop that and jump out to the street of Cairo. So I'll open the narrative, open that, and here we are, out at the street of Cairo. Let me load an embedded resources file now. So I'm going to import embedded resources, locate my file. Everything about the embedded resources are located along the bottom of the simulation window. The display differentiates between local and global resources. Local resources are spatially aware and they will change as you move through the modeled environment. Global resources are those that could be of interest to users regardless of their location in the virtual space. Resources can be simple annotations, links to a variety of file types, or links to web resources. Single-clicking on a resource opens its description. Double-clicking launches the resource. In this case, let's launch this PDF. So this is a PDF of a guide to the street published in 1893 and available on archive.org. Let's play the narrative and move into the street a little bit. And if you watch the embedded resources, you'll see that they begin to change as we hit other locally and spatially aware resources. Let's move up into the cafe area. We're still on the narrative, so on the pre-programmed tour. Watch out for these. Let me pause that. So taking a look, these are the photos that are available to us from this location. Let's try going out into the street a little bit more. This is a little tricky. Oh, sorry, I always trip over the chairs. So here we are. A white corner means that the viewer will be repositioned when the resource is launched. Here, an illustration from Daniel Burnham's Book of the Builders of the wedding procession that was staged daily in the street. So let's walk down the street a little bit so you can see how the resources change as we navigate through the environment. The different colors signal the different resource categories. These are user-defined to accommodate the needs of different scholars working with different models. If I stop and click Show All, you'll see the different resource categories. And if I double-click one of these resource categories, you'll see all of the resources within that category. Launching each of these resources in turn, here they all have repositions, is another interesting way to explore the model. You can also search and filter the resources. Now here, let me click search, type Cairo. Typing Cairo retrieves a number of results. Let's search through those, including, here's a good one, a link to a PDF from the ProQuest Historical Newspapers database of an article that was published in the Chicago Tribune, Fun in Cairo Street. Let me close that. Filtering lets users control the resources that are displayed while they explore the environment. If I choose photos, ephemera, and author's notes, you'll see that the resources displayed as I move through the street are now restricted to these categories. So here, let's stop. This resource says, there are text references to a fortune teller in the street of Cairo, but no photos have surfaced thus far. The sign on the building tells us that, according to the atlas included in Burnham's final official report, a fortune teller occupied this spot. Oh, wait a minute. What is this? My global resources are all messed up. Okay, if I turn filtering off, back, it's okay. Okay, that's better. Off. Oh, that just made it worse. Show all? No. Okay, show all. Back. Okay, better. Stop. So this is a prototype. Quite obviously, this is a prototype. It's a proof of concept to illustrate how one might use 3D models to study the built environment. Having seen this demonstration, despite that embedded resources bug, I hope you agree that the combination of academically generated 3D content, the ability to craft narratives in 3D space, and the ability to link to primary and secondary resources from within the modeled environment is a pretty powerful pedagogical tool. In the months to come, we'll be looking for funding to continue this work. The VSim prototype is great, but it's a prototype. It has its limits, and it definitely has its bugs. With additional funding, we'd like to conduct some coordinated user testing with content creators, scholars, educators, and students. We want to build a production-level version of the software that can be broadly distributed, and we want to build an archive for this type of content so that it can be easily shared. Keep your fingers crossed for us, and thanks for watching. Thank you.